Why is your performance limited in the heat for aerobic? And I'm guessing, is it limited to strength athletes too?
Yeah. So the in general, heat within a muscle can actually improve muscle performance. It increases enzymatic activities, and a lot of other aspects of the muscle performance can improve. So really in strength athletes, if body temperature is really is elevated, that you may not see any real difference in performance. We see this in sprinters and others as well. If their body temperature is too high, where they're actually having some, have to really, really thermoregulate, and they're having some other things, their sprint, their power may be, there might be some slight change, but it's pretty minimal because their bouts of exercise are so short. Once you get to longer distances, and I do a lot of work with track and field being here at University of Oregon, and we look at people around right when they start hitting with 800 meters and beyond distances. So we're talking, you know, anything around most two to anything longer than that. Then you start seeing these small decrements in performance as you get hot as with heat. The longer you go, the more you can have bigger deficits. And so the 10Kers, the marathoners, even the 5Ks, and certainly in cycling world, you know, most of our, there's very few except the track cyclists who are doing very extreme bouts. So the real thing that happens is your muscles need oxygen, right? And we deliver that through, by bringing more blood to the muscles. And that's why blood doping works. That's why every goal for a trained cyclist is to try and increase oxygen delivery to the muscles, and then we can utilize that. So anything that's pulling that oxygen away from the muscle is oftentimes going to decrease performance. So when you're getting a competition between thermoregulation, getting a competition between trying to deliver more blood to the muscles, more oxygen to the muscles, then you're going to have a competition that's going to be set up. And that's what usually decreases performance. There's mental sides of it too. People don't like to be hot and extremely hot, and they feel more fatigued. It's part of our defense mechanisms to make sure we don't overcook it, right, and get injured. So there's a lot of different factors that can play in, but definitely the longer distances, going to be more affected by heat.
And then what happens, how does your body actually cool? Because I think this is misunderstood.
Right. Yeah. So the thing that's interesting, and I always try to explain this to my students when I'm working in my class, and that is the first thing is that only 25% of the energy we create gets turned into actual work. The other 75% really is about us converting all that energy usage, and it gets, the byproduct is heat. So anytime you do exercise, you're going to get an increase in body temperature, and it's going to rise. So the way we dissipate that heat is through our blood. That's the first thing that happens. We use the blood perfuses our muscles. That's where in the blood gets increases temperature in the muscles. That then gets carried up to our core and out to our skin. And our skin, we then have the interface between our body and the environment. And so we can raise our skin temperature by having the increase in skin blood flow. Then we have the sweating mechanism. So the important thing about sweating is that it's linked to the rise in skin blood flow mechanistically, and we have to have evaporation of that sweat. So if you're on your trainer in your garage and you're cycling away and you're having pools of sweat dropping down, every drop that comes off did not cool you at all. You have to have that phase shift from a liquid to a gas. That takes energy. That energy comes from heat, and the heat was generated from your muscles originally. So to keep it simple, you go from the muscle generated the heat generated in your muscles is carried by the blood to the skin. And then when the evaporation of sweat occurs, that takes that same heat and dissipates it to the environment.
So how much does then just having a cool room? Because I hear a lot of cyclists or runners be like, oh, it's only 50 degrees in the room, so of course I was cool.
Right. Yeah. So I challenge anyone to go in a 50 degree room and then do one of your really hard trainer road workouts. You will be sweating. You'll be too hot unless you have no convective cooling of the fan. And part of the problem with that is if you're in a cool room, right, then at least the skin to air temperature gradient is a little better or a little more than it would be if you were in a warm room. So you got a little bit extra cooling, but you're going to create this bubble of humidity around you without having that convective movement of air across your skin to blow that humid air away. So you've got dry air. If you have dry air and wet skin, then you can evaporate. Humid air, wet skin, very little evaporation.
So does this get difficult then for athletes in like 100% relative humidity, like in extremely hot environments or humid environments?
Absolutely. Humidity is the really, really hard thing for humans. Humans can do really well and can tolerate remarkably high temperatures, even during exercise. in a very dry environment. As soon as it becomes more humid, then it gets much, much worse. And I've done, you know, personally done a number of races. I was born in Costa Rica, so I have a real love of the country and the people. And there's a race down there, La Ruta de los Conquistadores, the Route of the Conquistadors. And I went there kind of as a heat expert and to go do the race. And the first day is known to be brutally tough. I prepared in my chamber to get ready for the heat. Had a couple of setbacks on that. I won't go into the details on, but I was still pretty ready. I was not prepared for the humidity. And absolute in the jungle on the first day, there was no air movement at all. I was going, you know, 3 miles an hour tops, I think, and carrying our bike to the mud for periods of time. I've never been so miserable and hot and slow in my entire life. And that's almost entirely because of the humidity. Just brutal, brutal.
Yeah, I can relate. I did that when I went to Nationals in Sartell, Minnesota. I'd never dealt with humidity and it was crippling. My runs were absolutely terrible and I couldn't figure out what was going on, and then, you know, later put it together.
If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.
If you think I have better hair than Jonathan, give it a thumbs up. If not, leave a comment.
My hair is better than his.